Well, good morning. I welcome you this morning in this first Sunday that we have in springtime into this service of worship and praise today. We are a church that seeks to root people into the life-giving message of Jesus Christ. And I am so excited to be among many of you today, actually in person, in three-dimensional form. It is exciting to see you in this worship space. Now, if you are joining online, we are very excited to have you as well. I have been asked to share a couple of announcements this morning as we are moving toward this beautiful season of Easter. There will be a Holy Week prayer walk for families and for individuals this upcoming Saturday on March the 27th, beginning there, and continuing for individuals through April the 3rd. Now, this is a special interactive family experience that will be offered this Saturday, March the 27th, between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m. Now, sign-up is required, so check the website for more information. This event is planned to take place, rain or shine. Now, this would also be a great time to stop by and to pick up palms. You would be able to do that between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m. at the front entrance. Individuals and small groups are invited to participate at their own pace throughout the week following the Saturday family experience. So check that website for more information and for a prayer guide that you can take along with you on the Holy Week prayer walk. Palm Sunday service will be held online and in person, with limited attendance, and sign up is required. So for those who are attending in person, they will receive palms during that service, and everyone else can pick up palms in attendance at advance at any time during that prayer walk. And Monday, Thursday services will be held this year via Zoom. Good Friday will be held in person and online at 7 p.m., and again, sign-up is required. And for Easter celebration, we will be celebrating at sunrise in person at 7 a.m. We will also be holding a traditional Easter service at both 9:30 and at 11 a.m. There is limited in-person attendance, and of course, sign-up is required. Now, as we move toward that Easter celebration, I have also been asked to share with you a growing need. As we are having people in the worship space, we are beginning to see a need for ushers. So if you could serve to help out just a little bit, then I would invite you to contact either Mark Kohler or Pastor Milena for more information. That concludes our announcements this morning, so people, prepare to worship now the God who alone is worthy to be praised.
Amen. Yes, God is worthy of our praise. Will you join me now for our call to worship? The words are on your screen. We've come to worship God who makes streams flow from rock, who turns the parched earth into springs of water, who sends the rain from heaven and makes the wilderness blossom and flourish. As the deer thirst for flowing streams, so we thirst for you, O God. Come, let's worship our life-giving God, who pours out living water on all who thirst. Amen. Will you continue in our time of worship and joining us in our opening hymn, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. Things that I love about Lent is that this is a season that we get to lean into our spiritual disciplines, where we get to lean in and to experience God through prayer, through service, and through reading our word. And so this morning, I'm going to guide you through a special type of prayer. And if people who are at home have gotten the Lent box and Lenten kits, then you know about this prayer. And so I'm going to actually ask you to stand with me, because we're going to do a body prayer where we get to use our bodies in our prayer time. God, you are above. Now I want you to reach your arms to the sky. Below, as you're able, you may touch your toes. Inside, we can put our hands at our hearts. And all around, we can make a big circle. We worship you and give our lives to you. And we love you with all that we are. Now I want you to take 3 deep breaths in. and out. Another. And out. And another. And out. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. And now we may go to God with our joys and our concerns, with all of those prayers that are on our hearts. Will you pray with me now? Gracious and most loving God, God who created us, suffers because of us. God who died upon the cross suffers for us. God who dwells with us suffers with us. And in your suffering we find hope. Through your stripes we are made whole. Through you there is liberation and healing. Gracious God, we lift up all those in our community that are in need of your hope and your healing. We lift up all those families that are grieving and in need of your comfort. We lift up the families of those who were killed at the three spas in Atlanta. We lift up the families of Delana Young, Paul Andre Michaels, Xiaoji Tan, Dayu Feng, Hyun Jung Grant, Soon Chung Park, Suncha Kim, and Yang Yu. Lord, we ask for your comfort, your peace, and your justice. May your light shine in the darkness of racism and xenophobia, and that the rivers of justice flow like a never-ending stream. Lord, we lift up all those in our communities that are in need of your healing, those who are awaiting news, those awaiting surgery, those recovering from surgery, those recovering from injuries and sickness, and those who are going through cancer treatment, and those who are dealing with health concerns. We lift up Bonnie Scott, Donald Slocum, Howdy Kermish, Paul Jones, Linda Marie Red, Pat M.B., Ralph, Jeff Whetstone, Jim Hobart, Willa Brooks, Mary, Kate Harkness Hotstetter, Beth Sellers, Angela, and Jim Pearsall. Those who are ill with coronavirus and their families, we lift up all of the students and teachers who are navigating through this virtual and hybrid and in-person classrooms, and all those who are serving on the front lines in this pandemic, all of the doctors and nurses and medical professionals and all those who serve your people. Those who feel afraid and isolated and alone, and all those who are in need of your healing and hope, those that are grieving the loss of loved ones. Lord, we ask that you would give your comfort and your peace. Lord, strengthen and encourage all of the missionaries and all who serve in mission around the world, and to our service men and women around the world, and touch all of the local and national and international leaders. Impart your wisdom and use us all as instruments of your grace and your peace, and most importantly, of your love. We lift all of these prayers in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Just a poor wayfaring stranger, a traveling through this world of woe. But there's no sickness, toil, or danger in that bright land to which I go.
Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from John chapter 19, verses 28 through 29, and we are using the New Living Translation. Jesus knew that his mission was now finished, and to fulfill scripture, he said, "I am thirsty." A jar of sour wine was sitting there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put it on a hyssop branch, and held it up to his lips. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, before we dive right in, I got a question for you. I am wondering if any of you have ever been to the grocery store, maybe looking for some bottled water, and you have been amazed, maybe even confused, at the number of choices that are at the store. I had a friend of mine tell me that she had run an errand for her mother, and she went out just simply to pick up some bottled water. And she stood there thinking, my goodness, there must be at least 42 kinds of water here in the store. You see, there was like sparkling water and non-sparkling water and natural spring water and artesian water and zero calorie water, like what there was another option with calories that I wanted. There is a whole exhausting list of flavors like blackberry water and of course the obvious lemon or melon flavored water or lemon and lime or mint, or it's incredible the amount of choices that we have as Americans when it comes to our hydration. You know, and it got to wondering, if I were coming to America for the very first time, I might think that Americans are like the drinkingest people on the planet. Now, perhaps later on this afternoon, if you happen to be with mom or dad or a favorite grandparent, you can ask them to help you make some new flavors of water, like maybe with apple or a lemon. But don't try peanut butter, because that is just wrong. You see, yes, a trip to a local grocery store might lead you to believe that water is plentiful. But unfortunately, the truth of the matter is, it's not. It's kind of funny how our bodies are made up mostly of water, and yet at the same time, we have such a great need for it as well. Now, I am so proud of our very own Julia Barnes, who as a third grader heard about a need for water in Africa, about a place where there is tremendous water insecurity. And Julia responded to this need right out of her heart and immediately, and she decided to write a book and published it. So it's titled Willa's Adventures, and the proceeds of that actually helped to go fund the water project. So if you get a chance, you might Google that. And we have other adults here at Glenmar who have dedicated entire professional careers to ensuring that there is safe and drinkable water all across this planet. You see, water is not only good for the body, but it's necessary for life. Now, we often crave water. Our bodies are designed and meant to thirst. We are designed not only to experience thirst, but to actually have a need for thirst. It's a signal to our body. It's a signal that we need something to help us survive. And indeed, the need connects us with what is important, with what is critical for our survival. Now, I have a niece, and her name is Sharla. She is a nurse at a geriatric center in Wichita, Kansas. And she was telling me this week about a patient of hers that was refusing water. He was refusing this very thing that his body required. And he was doing everything he could to push away the medical professionals from giving him water. You see, he no longer had an inner push for this. In fact, he was resisting the very thing that was essential for his own survival. Now, isn't it funny that how sometimes what's good for us doesn't feel good at the time? Have you ever known anyone who on a hot summer day needed a tall glass of water, but instead they reached for a beer? Have you ever known anyone who resisted eating when clearly that person needed nourishment? If you have ever been with a loved one whose inner cravings seem to be misfiring, who resist or turn aside the very nourishment or hydration that is needed for survival, well, then you know the pain that that situation can bring. You may desperately want to help, and you know that they will be in trouble soon if they don't quench that thirst. But yet, their inner need signals have been dangerously scrambled. You see, my niece Charlotte has described a health community that often deals with patients who have an absence of the necessary craving impulse, one that is so essential. And I would submit to you today that this doesn't only occur in a physical realm, but it also occurs spiritually, that sometimes our signals get scrambled. You see, sometimes we forget that God is the source of exactly what we need and exactly what we are created for. Sometimes we forget that God is this source and we turn away, we resist. We resist reading Scripture. We resist praying. We resist connecting with a community of believers. But the psalmist wrote, "Oh God, you are my God. I seek you, my soul thirsts for you, my flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water." You see, the psalmist understood that spiritual thirst, but the psalmist also understood the source of its supply. Now, there is a hinge point that happens when something inside begins to go wrong, when the signal for that need turns, when need turns to greed, when desire turns to desperation. In fact, there is a term in the contemporary vernacular which accurately sums up this condition, and it's called thirsty. Now, thirsty, my friends, if you're not familiar with the term, thirsty is not a flattering term. You see, it's always used in the pejorative. It means that someone is just a little too eager for something. It means that they have become desperate. It means that they have forgotten a true source. It means that their need has twisted into some condition that they are responding to inappropriately. And this term can be used for just about anything, for compliments, for validation, for attention. It indicates, my friend, that a thirst has gone wrong. Now, perhaps you know what this looks like in real life. Perhaps we've seen it when those who are seeking accolades through achievement go for one achievement right after the other, and never any one of them satisfies. Thirsty. It can show up in a shop till you drop mentality where all of those Amazon packages keep piling up and they're stuffed in the basement and under the bed and in a hidden closet where charge cards are kept secret from a spouse just to cover that thirst. Yes, thirsty. It can show up as we scroll through endlessly our Pinterest pics, our Instagram feed, looking for a better life. Got you feeling like the one you are living isn't good enough. Perhaps you're feeling like the one that you are living just isn't enough, that you are never enough. Thirsty. Or maybe it shows up in the search for those internet sites that we won't mention in this setting, that consume your attention, that force you to sneak out of bed at night so you look at them, that you hide in your car to look at, that you would be embarrassed if your spouse or your child knew about. Thirsty. So while this term may describe what it looks like when things go wrong, you see, my friends, Jesus came to reset all of those inner cravings, to realign those desires, to eliminate the negative term and reconnect us with a supply that will truly satisfy. We are told earlier in the Gospel of John that there was one day that Jesus was attending a festival. And it's a large event where crowds are present, and everyone who's anyone seems to be gathered there, and they're all partying. It's a party atmosphere. You see, it is a festival. And at some point, Jesus stands up in the crowd and shouts, "Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come to drink. For the scriptures declare that rivers of living water will flow from their heart." You see, thirsty isn't a condition that we only encounter in our contemporary world. But the people of Jesus' day were also thirsty. They lived under the oppression of Roman rule, and they had a thirst for a governing system that would be fair, accurate, and see all the people. They lived in an era where spiritual leaders oftentimes were a bunch of pomp and circumstance. They were more interested in rules than they were in the people, and they had a thirst for spiritual leaders who truly cared. So what are we hungry for today? What are we thirsty for as a people? Perhaps we are searching for connection in a virtual world. Perhaps we long for release from an insatiable and hyper-greedy lifestyle. And surely we are thirsty, my friends, for justice in our land. When just this past year, we have been exposed to a viewpoint of the true valuation of humanity. Yes, we are thirsty. Thirsty to live in a world where racism does not exist. Thirsty to live in a world where our elderly and our children are valued as human beings. Thirsty to live in a world where we can be treated with fairness. We are not afraid to walk down the streets. Thirsty for a world where education is plentiful and the promise of a future is bright. And I wonder, my friends, do we go to God with our thirst, or do we turn to the things that do not satisfy? You see, the psalmist wrote in the 42nd Psalm that as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. By day the Lord directs his love, and at night his song is with me, a prayer to God for my life. And you see, one drink of this living water that only God can provide, just one drink, can change everything. There was a time when Jesus was traveling through Samaria, and he stopped by a city named Sychar. And there he sat down at a well. And there was a woman who came out that day to draw water. Now, the picture that we are painted of this woman indicates a person who has been thirsty for much of her life. And we see the degree by noticing the time that she comes to the well. You see, it's not early in the morning. She doesn't show up with the other women, oh no. She shows up when all of them are gone, when the prying eyes are gone, when the judging looks are gone, when the mumbled accusations about a messed up life are silenced. She sneaks out and comes to the well to draw water. And it was about noon that day when Jesus engaged conversation with her and asked her to give him a drink. And he said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is asking you for a drink, well, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. Now, that conversation that day, that drink changed everything for her. Suddenly, all her thirst was gone. And she left the well that day for the first time satisfied. Now, Susan Robb says that Jesus leads us to a life that is abundant, one that is joyful, one that is eternal. That Jesus can provide what the empty promise of failed politicians and church leaders cannot. And Jesus was on a mission to do just that, to quench the thirst of the people. Now, today's text locates us somewhere again around a noon hour. And again, we see Jesus as thirsty. Yet this time, he is at the end of his earthly life and his mission. And between the heat of the day, between the trauma that has been inflicted on his body, Jesus again is asking for a drink. And on the face of it, it would appear that that one request is a little misplaced. It might appear that he has given all that he can give and that the forces of darkness have indeed won for the hour. But yet, in John's gospel, Jesus is in control. You see, Jesus chooses to submit to this suffering. Jesus chooses to give all that he has to give, even his very life. And while it may appear to other people, and to us, when we look at the text, it might appear that the people are taking his life. Indeed, oh no, they're not. He is freely giving it away. You see, he said, no one takes my life from me. I give my own life freely. And this is Jesus' gift for us. So friends, I've got good news today. That at this hinge point in which our story turns, because Jesus has given freely, then we can freely receive. We can receive forgiveness. We can receive compassion. We can receive mercy, healing, freedom, all flowing like water. Like living, inexhaustible supply of water for you and for me. And the agony that accompanied his condition on that day, you will never have to bear. The agony that Jesus experienced in that moment is not ours to experience. For he was there that day, that hour, to once and for all quench our thirst. He poured out of himself and provided his own spirit, the spirit of living water, as a gift for you and I. that we might never thirst in desperation, that we might never be thirsty not knowing where our source is, but that we might thirst in need and come to Him and have that need supplied. And one drink, just like it was for that woman who showed up at the well, one drink of this living water can change everything. You see, 5 minutes alone with God in scripture, in prayer, or in worship can do more than many years of planning, of preparation, or even of therapy. And I would invite you to practice your thirst in the Spirit. You see, there is a place where we can take all of our anxiety, all of our twisted cravings, all of our loneliness, our emptiness, our longing, and our deepest thirst. There is a place where we will be met with living water, with water that will truly satisfy. It is a place of prayer. It is a place of scripture. It is a place of fellowship with God, and it is at its heart a place of worship. Now, Michael Smith says it like this: "As the deer panteth for water, so my soul longeth after thee. For you, O Lord, are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You, O Lord, are my strength, my shield, and to you, O Lord, does my spirit yield. You, O Lord, are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee." Now, when we are properly hydrated, physically and spiritually, when we are properly and sufficiently nourished, then we are empowered to make a difference in the world in which we live. Ask any school teacher, and they will tell you that a hungry child will not really be able to learn. But when they've been fed, when they have been properly hydrated for the day, watch out, because that child might be able to do just about anything. And you see, when we have spent time drinking in the goodness of God, when we have spent time in scripture, when we have spent time in prayer, when we have spent time in worship, then we too are empowered by the Holy Spirit to make a difference in the world. We are able to share from this inexhaustible supply, that source of living water that flows through us like rivers. And we have received these waters from God, and we can share them with the world around us. So much so that we become a resource for others who are dry and who are weary. So my prayer for us today, as we near this Easter season, that this living water might flow freely through us, that others would experience from us that sort of inexhaustible supply of love and forgiveness, of mercy and of justice. A justice that rolls down like water, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Amen. There is a saying that goes, love ventilates itself in giving. And often that happens in a hug or in a smile or maybe in a kind word. And sometimes that happens just because we've been helping people out of the abundance of our own resources. We are asked to give out of the abundance of our resources. And I believe that you and I have abundance indeed. Sometimes it is just simply that kind word because we have received kindness. Sometimes it is comfort because we have received comfort. And sometimes that shows up monetarily. Oftentimes this comes in a very practical way through the church. I am reminded that just over this past week, Glenmar was able to help a family that was struggling with rent and facing eviction, and the abundance of resource was able to stave that off and to ensure that that family has housing this week. That's just one of the many ways that your financial giving through Christ's body, through Glenmar Church, makes a difference. In that way and in so many other ways. Now today you can give in several ways. If you are gathered here in the Spirit Center, there will be an opportunity for you to drop off an offering before you leave. Now if writing a check happens to be your thing, then you can simply write that check and send it to the address that you see on your screen, 4701 New Cut Road, Ellicott City, Maryland, 21043. You can also give electronically by clicking on the green Give button on whatever platform you happen to be watching right now, and you can also give by text, simply texting Give to the number that you see on your screen before you. So as we prepare to share what we have with others, I would invite you to pray. Loving God, you have given out of the abundance of your heart and of your very self. We pray right now that you would move upon us to follow that modeling of love, to trust you for the resources that we need, and to give out of our abundance, out of our heart, and to make a difference in this world. Hear our prayer, O God. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess. Here I find my rest, and without you I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. I need you, my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, now I need you. My sin runs deep, your grace is more, the peace is found. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Praise God. Oh, how we need. I have to say, Pastor Anna, you were in my business when you were talking about the Amazon packages. I'm going to need you to stay out of my closet. Starting next week, we will begin to have the prelude before service, and so it'll start about that 9:55. And so for everyone who was tuning in at home, you don't want to miss the prelude, and so make sure you tune in a little earlier. Will you join me now for our closing prayer? Gracious and loving God, as we journey through this season of Lent, opening ourselves to your grace, we ask that you will guide us into a true change of heart and reorientation of our lives. Lord, I ask that you would reset us, those mechanisms that are thirsting or being thirsty for those things that are leaving us dehydrated and in need. Reorient us, Lord, that we might thirst for you, our living water. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who showed us how to live and to love. Amen. And will you join us now for our closing hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Through the storm.
now to him who is able to keep you from falling, to him who is the provider of all that you need. I pray that you would be able to reach out this week to that inexhaustible supply of living water that can quench your real thirst and realign your desires. May you find peace in God this week and serve this world in love. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.